Alrighty, Max here. I'm gonna do something totally unheard of today by being a filmmaker making a video essay on film about a film that I didn't help make whatsoever, but I'm gonna let you know why I love it so much and why it might deserve your second viewing. So, what are we looking at today? Well, we're looking at what many consider the downfall of film today, the comic book superhero movie. Which one are we talking about today, though? Well, it's my favorite superhero comic book webhead loving movie out there, Spider-Man Into the Spider-Verse. I don't know if you've heard of it. I don't think it gets nearly enough praise.
And the Oscar goes to?
Okay, but no, seriously, I think it doesn't get enough praise. It's genuinely one of my favorite works of art because, well, it's just genuinely a work of art. So what was this movie again? For any of those it's been a while for, Into the Spider-Verse follows our protagonist Miles Morales, a young kid in a middle-class family living in Brooklyn. Miles is recently starting a new private boarding school he won in a lottery to have entry into. But he struggles with accepting this new life, seeing it as disingenuous. His overbearing father, Jefferson, is pushing Miles to advance at his new school, which further pushes Miles away from it. Miles tries flunking out, but his teacher catches this and makes him write a self-reflective essay on what type of person he wants to be. Of course, instead of doing his assignment, he takes a much-needed break to visit his uncle. Together, they hang out and throw up some of his cool art, but then, uh-oh, he gets a spider bite! So you know what that means.
With great power comes great responsibility.
A quick rundown of the rest is big bad guy's doing big bad thing. Good guy tries to stop bad guy while new kid gets tangled up in it. Bad guy's bad thing goes bad from good guy doing good thing, but good guy died. But it's okay because the bad thing going bad from good guy doing good thing brought in more good guys. New guy struggles to keep up with the good guys and learns his lesson and then isn't struggling anymore and stops bad guy and helps the other good guys. Oh what, that didn't make the movie sound overly interesting? Well no, summaries never do that, so hold on. What makes this seemingly surface-level story so interesting is its enhancement through its art. Into the Spider-Verse is a 3D animated... Wait, no. Into the Spider-Verse is a 2D anima... No, hang on. Into the Spider-Verse is a 2-3D animated movie. It combines aspects of both 2D and 3D animation. They do this a lot through the process of cel shading. Cel shading is the process of shading a 3D object to appear flat in 2D. Early examples of this were made to create characters and environments in 2D animations that were too complex to be drawn by hand, or made in 3D to more easily and accurately be animated. After some time, it became more of a stylistic choice in some animations to add flair to them. So Spider-Verse isn't the first cartoon to do it. Hell, it isn't even the first Spider-Man cartoon to do it. But here it has an amazing purpose of making a 3D character look like a 2D moving comic drawing. It made a comic book movie a comic book movie. But it's not as simple as just making a 3D character look 2D. If that were true, just throw on a filter onto Endgame and then it would be a perfect comic book movie, right? But there's the obvious problem of real people colored strange would look, well, strange. But this being an animated cartoon, the characters are also cartoons. They can move, interact, and fight like actual comic book characters. They can move around your screen in possible ways to make a fight or action more interesting visually in a way live action just can't. Comic books provide a story with not just impossible characters, but impossible movements, framing, and perspectives that are always changing. Something that when attempted to be told and replicated in live action can be exciting, but also kind of bland and a mess of muddled simple actions. So beyond good animators, how does this story fit a comic book so well? The cinematography. Like I mentioned before, a comic book has constantly changing framing, perspective, and most terrifying, aspect ratios. When creating a composition of a hero, you want them to look, well, you know, heroic. To focus the reader's attention, comics play with the framing of cutting the ratio, changing the shape of the frame, and rearranging the reading order. In film, a constantly changing aspect ratio and framing can be incredibly distracting. Into the Spider-Verse does this to their advantage. While focusing your attention with small frames, they still fit the rest of your screen with other frames, sometimes showing you actions in order one after another or showing multiple vantage points at once. This replicates the feel of a comic so much they literally show you a moving comic book at some points to tell the story. Beyond that, contrast is everything to the framings here. This is where the cel shading technique shines so much. The lighting and shading is done in overlays to the characters and environments made up of tiny dots. The dots are made up in a grid layering over top the original coloring of a character to make this mixed color gradient look. In older comics, this was done to create a shading and coloring. A great example is in a lot of skin tones at the time were being colored with a white background having a mix of red, yellow, or brown dots over top. This dot technique is called bendé after the original artist who popularized it. Here to add complexity to a character, they use brighter dots to create light and darker dots to create shadow to make it feel like an original comic drawing. This also allows for the movie to fake its depth of field. There are technically no out-of-focus spots in this movie, because there are none in a comic book. Everything in a comic book is drawn with sharp lines. So to keep that look but still provide a cinematic look, they fake it. So instead of a faraway object becoming blurry, they simply misalign the shading layers. This is also common in old comic books. Although it was never intentional, there would be misalignments in older printed comics. To color everything on a page in a single drawing, it needs multiple passes of colors and ink. It's very common to see imperfection and misalignments like this in old printed passes of comic books. You might see one pass slightly misaligned, like a blue or red layer not match up with everything else, which can create a blurry out-of-focus look. This is how you get your out-of-focus spots in the movie. It's a lot like when you take your 3D glasses off while watching a 3D movie. When people ask me what my favorite part of Into the Spider-Verse is, it's honestly how they creatively made this depth of field. Beyond all that, they used the idea of the dots with the collider. The model of the collider itself is already made up of a grid of dots. But when the explosion of lasers start, it's made up of an explosion of dots. It gives the classic look of Jack Kirby's comic art, where he was famous for using a mix of dots in his art style. And servicing the purpose of the collider, which is to bring aspects in from other universes, it's like literally taking the dots that make up the other worlds and colliding them together in ours. It's a nice little detail. Okay, so now we have a plan for animation and an overall look for the movie. But how do we make it even better? Editing the action and dialogue. One thing that's done to really spice up this movie is its little additions of 2D aspects and drawings to spice up movements and action. When characters move too fast for a single frame to capture it all, they draw in extra duplicated limbs and items to add the feel of speed or movement. It's kind of like your classic Scooby-Doo runoff gag. And when those limbs land a punch or touch on something, you get those classic spiky yellow bubbles to shine off the action. And to add more flair and direction to the movements, there are movement lines. They can be as simple as lines falling behind a movement or actually using something in the frame and scene, like passing by snow. And then beyond that, sometimes just to make a frame more like a frame of a comic book, they get rid of the background altogether and paint in a splash page of color or exploding lines for big character moments. A detail not made with 2D, but through 3D to mimic 2D, is the use of frame rate. Usually, the average movie is shot at about 24 frames a second. But in animation, sometimes that number is lower and can be done at 12 frames a second. Mainly because back in the day, drawing 24 frames just takes more time than 12. Obviously, drawing less frames is faster and more cost-effective, but it provides a choppy look to the movements of characters. So to provide a more 2D look, sometimes the movie will change its frames per second. Some actions' movements will lose a couple frames right before it happens to add more of a pop or a punch to an action. But it's also done to tell the story. Pointed out a lot, you can see Miles is a bit boxy and choppy in his movements. This is on purpose. He's purposely kept at a lower frame rate than Spider-Man to give Spider-Man a smooth and acrobatic-like appearance to juxtapose Miles, who is new and amateur. Specifically in the scene where he first web swings, you can see him at a lower frame rate when swinging with Spider-Man, but slowly comes into the same frame rate as Spider-Man and comes into sync with him to show Miles is learning. More so than action, the characters have line work on their faces to create their expressions and wrinkle lines on their faces. This emphasizes the emotion and meaning behind the words of the 3D models that otherwise would come across more matted and flat-like in many other 3D animated characters. But again, it serves a purpose for the visual style looking like a drawn comic book character. More so than all that, probably the most noticeable additions of 2D are in the dialogue. Comic books tell their stories mostly through their action. You can understand 90% of a comic book story through just looking at the pictures, seeing a character's face's emotions, and which character that person is fighting. But for the few moments of needed dialogue, comics use speech bubbles. In the movie, this comes in the form of hearing a character's thoughts through the speech bubbles, adding emotion to a character wearing a mask who can't express emotion as well, or adding to a sound effect whether small or loud. It gives the effect of that old Batman pop and pow, but with a little bit more integration into the scene. So now that we have all these additions to the frame, how do we make it even more comic book-like? The color. Most people might look at this movie and think, ah, bright colorful images. Yeah, it's an animated movie.
Got a problem with cartoon?
But there's purpose to the coloring. For instance, there's this recurring theme of the backgrounds having an overall single color. This was done in comics because it helps to cut down on the cost of not printing detail in color where it's not as needed. But it also serves the purpose of helping to outline and focus the attention of a character in the frame. The streets of New York tend to have a red theme with an orange glow, while the nightscape and rooftops tend to have colder blue tones. Interiors and exteriors all throughout the movie keep a solid one-color theme that helps provide a mood for the location and provides a focus to our main characters who get to keep their complex designs and colors. And speaking to characters' colors, it's hard to not notice each character's color theme, especially when each spider hero is sent home, there's a literal splash of their color theme. And yeah, they're mostly red and blue, because you know, Spider-Man is red and blue, but there's some exceptions here. Obviously, Spider-Man Noir is a contrast of black and white for the noir theme. But then you reach Spider-Gwen. A lot of her popularity in the comics originally came from her costume, visually one of the more interesting spider suits ever made. While her costume is mostly black and white, she has accents of magenta and light blue. These accents provide her her theme. Her world is painted in it. There's a lot of moments she gets to shine, and it's always highlighted with this theme of a magenta pink and light blue. This helps to establish her as her own spider hero, not relying on having to follow the Peter Parker Spider-Man of red and blue. And if you know anything about her comic counterpart, one of her major character points is that at some point, her and Miles end up together, and the pink color helps to highlight a romantic undertone with her and Miles, especially in their send-off scene, and when she returns back at the end through a portal. I mean, you don't even see her in the scene, and even if you didn't hear her voice, you would be able to immediately tell it was her who was visiting Miles because of the color of the portal. Beyond all that, the most important color to focus on is of our main characters. Miles has a couple of themes that happen here. Blue, red and blue, black and red, but what does that all mean? Going back to the story I originally said was seemingly surface level is about to get a whole subsurface addition. The art is our shovel for digging. Miles is at the heart of this. I mean, obviously, but why does this character make this so good? Well, let's go back to color. When we are first introduced to this world, we see this universe's Peter Parker Spider-Man. After his sped through origin, we meet Miles. We get Miles' room and his passion for art. The whole room is kind of just a gray blur with splashes of colors from Miles' belongings, and more importantly, his art. That's cut short when we go to his first day of school, where he throws on his uniform and rushes off. He moves through the streets of New York past his old school until finally arriving at his new school. Did you see the color changes? We start with a character wearing neutral colors, until putting on a blue jacket that reflects his blue-colored school. The cold blue gives us this sterile, off-putting presence to everything. Miles doesn't like it here. He doesn't feel welcome. Where would he rather be? Well, I mean, he says it, amongst his people, where we just were. On the warmly colored streets of New York, by his old school, where we get a diverse splash of color from the students where his colorful art is going to be assumedly more accepted and appreciated. Where is this also not immediately accepted? His father, who guess what, has the theme of blue, being a police officer. We finally get to see Miles as himself when he ditches his school and his assignment to see his uncle. This is where we get our first warm, inviting room where we get to see Miles in his own clothes, which of course have a theme of black and red. And this warm setting gives us an accepting setting for his art, where we get an important color, red. This all draws the attention to not just the theme of red and blue, but red versus blue. Miles looks up to his dad and Aaron, who are his two largest role models, and this establishes a pull for what type of person Miles is going to be. Uncle Aaron or Officer Davis? This is the question until the call to action, which pushes him into a new path of red and blue working in tandem. And it's no accident that when Spider-Man and Miles realize they have the same powers at first, Spider-Man's powers are represented in red and blue, while Miles, who hasn't accepted this yet, has an opposing purple and green, which is the soon-to-be-discovered theme of his uncle's villain alter ego, the Prowler. It's also, you know, the color scheme of like 90% of Spider-Man's other villains. Miles doesn't know yet, but the idol he has chosen in his uncle over his dad would actually be his downfall. Whenever we revisit his uncle's apartment, it's no longer the red warm hue that established Miles' comfort. It starts to lose it and become cold. We especially see that transition when Miles is working against the new Spider-Man, where the apartment has a half red and half blue scheme. Miles, of course, on the red half and Spider-Man on the blue half. Showing Miles that he currently believes this to be the right path and this to be a warm, inviting place, but once he begins his journey as Spider-Man, we'll see this as the wrong path and the wrong place to be. Obviously, Miles has already started his path. He's wearing a Spider-Man suit, but it's a kid's costume. It's tight and loose in all the wrong places, kind of like his school uniform. He's uncomfortable in the setting. He's a little kid playing dress-up in the big leagues. And when he has to escape on the fly with Spider-Man, he has to use a web shooter. Again, not his size. This isn't his fit. Miles even questions the new Spider-Man he got, who has lost his way in comparison to the perfect, clean, and young Spider-Man that was just killed. And he struggles until he...
Stop listening to me!
Miles learns to be his own Spider-Man. The other Spider-Heroes he comes across didn't have a mentor. They got that way trusting themselves in their own journey. Miles begins to realize he can't rely on already established heroes to bring the hero out of himself. And upon realizing his uncle's identity and soon after death, obviously that's no longer a path he can pursue. It takes what is probably the most emotional scene of his father telling him he's only pushed him in this way because he recognizes his creativity and his worth as his son. The one major role model in his life who hasn't accepted him fully provides the chance for Miles to fully trust in himself and his ability to forge his own path. This is when he finally gets his own suit, his own web shooters, and most importantly, he ties his shoes. Wait, hang on, wait, his shoes? Wait, what the fuck? Yeah, his shoes. The entire movie, no matter his costume, he's wearing his shoes, with his color scheme of red and black. He chooses to leave them untied, which is pointed out, but it's a style choice, just like he chooses a lifestyle against the idea of prosperity and pretends to be less than that. It's a theme that I think most can relate to, the idea of not flaunting your prosperity and wealth in the guise of being lesser and having more struggle. The underdog idea of I in the same place as someone but with more struggle than that someone makes me better than that someone, which in some cases can be true, but in the case of being disingenuous to your true self can only hold you back. When Miles originally wants to be his own Spider-Man before meeting the others, he takes a leap of faith. Which he fails because why? That's right, his shoes. His shoelaces were untied. It's not until after realizing that the Spider-Man in his life won't make him Spider-Man, but he has to trust himself to become Spider-Man, that he is secure in himself. He ties his shoes and he takes the leap. The others even notice this when they realize they didn't teach him how he's acting as Spider-Man. And of course, the cherry on top is he gets his own personal suit that he made with his art skills that of course were before not truly appreciated. But beyond all that, these choices show character growth in not just one character, but our two main characters. We've obviously shown that Miles has grown, but so does Spider-Man. This new older Spider-Man struggles with the idea of how he has failed in his own universe. He's about in the same place as the original Spider-Man we see, but a couple years older, he's less financially stable, he's lost his Aunt May, and most importantly to him, him and MJ have split up due to his fear of having kids with her. The overarching theme with Spider-Man has always been balance and the struggle that comes with reaching it. It makes sense he would fear the extra responsibility of fatherhood on top of the responsibility of already being Spider-Man. But he learns it's possible through Miles, who even though Miles comes into his own trusting in himself, would never have been able to reach that point without Peter. When we see Miles throughout the story, other than his shoes, his one repeating costume piece is a white t-shirt, showing that this character is a blank slate, like a blank white t-shirt or a blank essay yet to be written, or even a blank page yet to be drawn. In trying to discover his identity, he keeps trying on different costumes over this blank slate, and none of them work, until he realizes for him to be himself, he needs to combine all of these aspects of himself to be the best he can be, in other words, the best Spider-Man he can be. And when he does, he can send all the endangered spider heroes home, and like I said previously, all of their send-offs have a splash of their color theme, except for Peter Parker Spider-Man. When he gets sent home, he gets a blank white light splashed, because like Miles, Peter is getting a new clean slate to decide what type of Spider-Man he's going to be. After the relentless complaints of people complaining of seeing the same superhero origins over and over, this movie likes to poke fun at the idea of how many times we've seen Spider-Man's origin. At least Miles as a character we've never gotten an origin for, but when you really look at it, this isn't just an origin for Miles, but Peter again. Yeah, that's right, everyone who has complained about seeing origin stories was just tricked into seeing 6 origin montages and 2 overarching origins in this movie. How did people let this movie do that to them? All this is told through the writing, but specifically enhanced by the art that came right off the pages of a comic book, which is what makes Spider-Man Into the Spider-Verse the best comic book movie ever.